The irony, of course, being that if you can fucking talk, you aren't going to blow up. Hey everybody, it's been a while since I recorded a minisode, and today I was working on our exclusive newsletter for February for the endurance hacker community, and I was working on a topic that I felt like would be valuable for the entire listenership, and so I decided that I would share some of the topic ideas with you today in short form so that you can kind of see what we discuss in that community, and then also because I think it'll be very beneficial for you. For those of you that don't know, the Endurance Hacker Society is Lionheart Radio's in-house endurance community. When you join the Endurance Hacker Society, you actually get access to a bunch of different programs. You know, we have the EH base building program, which is 14 weeks long, including testing. The program goal is to maximize strength, aerobic development, and injury prevention, and we try to have everybody start there. We also have a first marathon program, which is 16 weeks long. The program goal is to obviously complete your first marathon. And then we have a marathon PR program, 16 weeks long as well. But if you've already ran a marathon and you're ready to add some speed into your life, then this is the plan for you. We also have an ultra program, 16 to 24 weeks, depending on distance. Program goals are for 50K, 50 miler, and 100 mile distances. For anything longer, you know, let us know and we'll definitely work and customize for you. But there's not too many of us out there that ever want to go longer than 100 miles. We also have lifting for endurance athletes. That program is ongoing. The program goal is that you'll receive 3 strength workouts a week, and they can be an additive to your current training plan. This one is ideal for anyone that already has a coach or a plan that they like, but wants to leverage lifting to get faster and become more resilient. And then lastly, we have the GPP Endurance Program. That's like our general preparedness program, and that's also ongoing. If you're like me, you just kind of want to be able to compete in whatever, whenever. This program doesn't have a peak phase, but goes through many different cycles throughout the year. The goal being that you can pick and choose whatever discipline you want. That is what I followed last year to run all 10 of my ultras. Quick side note, we're currently working on a triathlon training program, which will launch this summer as well. Okay, so on to the minisode topic. I want to talk about the role of tech in training. Now, my approach to training is pretty damn simple. Our bodies were naturally meant to lift, climb, run, and endure. Our ability to get back to that state is contingent on our ability to live in a way that is consistent with our evolution. That means more whole food and less processed garbage. More pacing on intuition than on what an algorithm says you should be doing. More barefoot style running and less so-called innovative shoe technology. What I found is that many interventions get abused, used as a crutch, and as a result, our natural ability to excel becomes dampened. That being said, it would be ill-informed to try and ignore the value and the role that technology can play if it is leveraged properly. So here are my outlooks on some of the more commonly used methods and where they fit into our EH program or how you could fit them into your program. So technology and food. Whole real food is probably the biggest area that people could squeak more performance out of their current program. We have a tendency to rely heavily on supplementation, but honestly, people would be amazed, you know, I know that I was, when they cut everything crappy and or fake out of their diets and focus on whole real food. Supplements will give you an average of about 1 to 3% boost in performance, and I would and do leverage them for recovery, but just know that whole real food is the real low-hanging fruit to increasing your performance. Although it's filled with marketing hyperbole, the best place to start, in my opinion, if you are interested in this approach, is the Whole30. They have tons of free downloads and resources to get you going in the right direction, and it kind of builds it into a challenge format, which makes it really easy to follow along with. And if you're anything like me, you have a tendency to fall off the wagon hard. Having a program like this definitely helps. I want to keep this section short because I have an entire talk on the EH approach to nutrition and supplementation that I'll be giving out soon. In general, though, you're best served to stay away from preservatives and fillers that don't rely on supplementation to pick up where your diet lacks. Eat a diet that doesn't lack, and then use sups to edge out additional performance. If you do it the other way around, you are most likely leaving some performance on the table. new kicks. Nike has done more to fuck up the knees and hips of Americans than any other brand, maybe ever. And that is simply because they put profits above well-being for a really long time. It was only when minimalist and barefoot running became popular that they began to offer a shoe that is actually compatible with the human condition. Now, don't take this as an affront to bash Nike. They've done a ton to further sport and athleticism, and I understand that, but I'm just stating the facts. For many years, the Nike Shock won best running shoe, and that thing basically rivaled high heels. The added heel on any shoe makes heel striking almost a necessity. The obvious problem here is that every stride you take with your heel hitting first, it mimics slamming on the brakes, in essence causing you to restart momentum each time you step. The other problem is that it takes the body's natural shock absorbers, the arch of the foot and the calf, and they're largely taken out of the equation. What's left is a bone stacked on bone combo, and that takes the brunt of the abuse. Picture your heel and then your tib and your fib above that, just trying to take all of that pounding for miles or hours. Over time, this will manifest as hip or knee pain, not to mention allowing your foot the ability to be lazy. This is to blame for the sloping arch that many people experience. For the longest time, I suffered from plantar fasciitis in runner's knee, the classic patella pain that sidelines many runners before they ever get to their goal. Literally, a half marathon would leave me with the inability to even walk right for weeks. It wasn't until I switched to the Vibram five-finger shoe for a period of time and taught myself how to run correctly that all of that changed. The beauty of that shoe is that it literally forces you to run correctly. The transition was rough, but worth it. I leveraged the pose method as a way of easing into it, and you can literally just Google the pose method and you can download that, and it gives you a good protocol to run into the five-finger shoe. Over time, I quit using the goofy five-finger shoe but kept the form using a midfoot strike and haven't had any issues with either since then, knock on wood. Now, in choosing shoes, I just make sure to pick something with a wide toe splay and no drop from the heel to the rest of the foot. Typically, the more support, the worse off you are. My favorite brand so far is Altra, that's A-L-T-R-A, and no, this is not a paid ad. I just like what I like. All right, heart rate variability training, or HRV. In essence, HRV measures the state of your sympathetic nervous system, which gives you a look at how recovered you are at that time. It does this by looking at the time it takes for your heart to contract, i.e. the time in between heartbeats. The idea being that the time will be shortened or erratic when your body is trying to recover. While the science behind this is promising, it is the way that we implement it that can screw it up. For example, while HRV is a reliable way of measuring recovery, there are many lifestyle factors that can influence it, such as caffeine or even what you are thinking about. This has become really studied and obvious lately, but of course, the emotions that we have and the way that we think affects our physiological being. Just think about the last time you were really stressed out and couldn't eat. The metaphysical world always has a really weird way of manifesting itself in the physical world, and I've seen this with HRV, and that's one of the reasons you have to be careful. Last year, I was approached by one of the industry's leaders about sponsorship, but I found when using it, I couldn't rely too heavily on it. For example, one morning after measuring, it told me not to train because I wasn't recovered. In fact, it said I was at the lowest level, categorized as overtrained. That same day, I PR'd my half marathon and I felt great. This is a great example of why you can't rely on technology too much to dictate your training. If you are interested in using HRV, I would suggest that you use it as simply another input. Measure yourself in the same state, typically 5 minutes after waking while lying in bed, for 4 weeks. Don't allow it to dictate your training at all. Simply record your results in your training log, and then train however you are going to do that day anyway. After a month, look back and see if the results of what it told you were consistent with how you felt and performed that day. If so, if it was, and if you have the freedom and flexibility in your schedule, then I would say it's something worth using more to set up your weekly training. This was the experiment that I did to learn that, in fact, the results were not going to be worth the time investment for me. For now, my training schedule each week is still heavily influenced by my intuition. But it's worth noting that that's something you will only gain when your training age is old enough. heart rate zone training. Pacing is something that is very easy to define and has nothing to do with your feelings. For example, if your goal is to qualify for the Boston Marathon, you can feel like you are running fast enough, but if the time it takes you to run each mile doesn't reflect that, you aren't going to be running in New England in April. Now, this is obvious. But what I like about heart rate training is that it tells you exactly how much you are exerting at each pace. For example, if I know that you are running an 8:30 mile at a heart rate between 170 and 180 beats per minute, I can use that heart rate zone to increase duration and progress your ability to go further using that zone. I can use it just like we would weight in a linear progression in a strength plan, adding duration or intensity each week. This makes it extremely valuable when it comes to speed work. It also gives you a great reference point so that training on intuition can become easier in the future. In other words, you will know how each pace feels. Oftentimes, we think we are exerting more effort than we really are. In that way, heart rate training is a valuable litmus test. Where it can go wrong, however, is when the opposite becomes true. When your heart rate is telling you you are maxed out, but you are definitely not. As we discussed above, heart rate can be affected by so many outside factors. In episode number 38 of Lionheart Radio, I talked to Brian McKenzie, and he told us a story of a training partner that he had that was repeatedly telling him that he couldn't go any faster while running, that he was about to blow up, according to his heart rate. The irony, of course, being that if you can fucking talk, you aren't going to blow up. So that story highlights a point that is probably the congruent theme throughout this entire episode, which is just like everything else, tech is never the end-all be-all when it comes to getting a physiological adaptation. It is simply a tool and should be treated as such.
Thanks for listening to Lionheart Radio. I hope that the information from today's show will make you fitter, happier, and healthier. For the show notes of this episode and every episode, head to www.lionheartrad.io. Yep, just like Lionheart Radio. And please, if you have the time, head over to iTunes and give us a 5-star rating. It really helps us to know that we're on the right track and delivering you reliable information and value. As always, feedback is welcome. If you have any comments on the show or would like to suggest a guest, send me an email at rick@luavive.com. That's luavive.com. Thanks for your support, and we will see you next time.
Bitch, I feel good. Don't I look stupendous? My shine is so endless, and shit you can do to end this. Even when I'm dead, niggas still gon' bump that chip shit. Coke white, escalate on cinches for you dipshits. So you won't forget this. Me and West, nigga, be the coldest. Cleveland is